Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya.
We'll be reading this morning from Canto 3, Chapter 18, the battle between Lord Bor and Hiranyaksha. And we'll start with text number 9. Going back to the context, this is Maitreya speaking to Vidura based upon some inquiries that Vidura made. And Vidura was told by Uddhava that before Krishna left, Krishna spoke of you. And he said, Krishna said, very soon, Uddhava, Vidura will come. And when Vidura comes, send him to Maitreya to hear from him. So, following that instruction, Vidura went in the direction that Uddhava had indicated and found Maitreya, exchange between the two, respect and respect, mutual respect, and Vidura presented questions to Maitreya, and outstanding, especially in the beginning, was abundant questions about creation. And so the middle part of Canto 3 is questions, excuse me, the creation, details and details. And early, in the early stages of creation, is where Hiranyaksha and Hiranyakashipu come, sons of Diti. And this is the slaying of Hiranyaksha. Hiranyaksha, this canto, chapter 17, describes Hiranyaksha in service to his elder brother Hiranyakashipu. He was gathering gold from wherever he could find it and bringing it to Lanka. And he gathered so much gold, according to what Prabhupada writes, from the other side of the planet by subway, by a tunnel through the earth to the other side of the planet, and taking so much gold, so much that there was an imbalance of the earth and the earth fell out of its orbit. Bottom of the Garbhagriha Ocean, the demigods approached Vishnu, help! And Vishnu said, yes, I'll help. So he assumed the form of a boar, plunged into the bottom of the Garbhagriha Ocean, Ananda's tusks was lifting the earth planet to put it back in its proper place. As he was doing this, Hiranyaksha came to know from Varuna, he wanted to challenge Varuna to battle, and he said, you're too powerful, but you want someone's good match for you. Go, Vishnu. And by the way, he's in the Garbhadak Ocean rescuing the earth that you caused to fall out of orbit. So Hiranyaksha went searching for Lord Vishnu. He found Varaha rescuing the earth, challenged, insulting, chivalrous remarks back and forth, and then the battle has begun. So this is the battle between Lord Bor and Hiranyaksha. And we've been hearing that Maitreya has been saying again and again and again, this form of the Lord in Prabhupada and his purports is all spiritual. It's a mistake, or stronger, it's an offense to consider this form or any of the forms of the Lord as being a material body, and inside there's the soul or something like that. Wrong. Mistaken. So it's a transcendental form and transcendental activity. And so even in with transcendence, he's entering into this world and he's having this encounter with Hiranyaksha. So here's a description of, some ongoing description. Hiranyaksha's, what his opulences and his appearance were. Text 9, the demon who had a wealth of ornaments, bangles, and beautiful golden armor on his body chased the Lord from behind with a great mace. The Lord tolerated his piercing ill words, but in order to reply to him, he, that's Lord Bor, expressed his terrible anger. Report. The Lord could have chastised the demon immediately while the demon was deriding the Lord with ill words, but the Lord tolerated him to please the demigods and to show that they should not be afraid of demons while discharging their duties. Therefore, his toleration was displayed mainly to drive away the fears of the demigods, who should know that the Lord is always present to protect them. The demon's derision of the Lord was just like the barking of dogs, and the Lord did not care about it, since he was doing his own work in delivering the earth from the midst of the water. Materialistic demons always possess large amounts of gold in various shapes, and they think that a large amount of gold, physical strength, and popularity can save them from the wrath of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Just a comment will go on. Wrath of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Anger of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Now, one of the things is, in growing up in a Christian family, in a Christian country, in a Christian tradition, largely, I mean, there are other versions, but largely, one of the things that really bothered me was the intimidation thing. Now, where I grew up, that wasn't prevalent, but there are places where it's prevalent. We have the current Radha Govinda Mandir is in Brooklyn. There's a shopping area a couple blocks away called Albee Square, and there was a series of guys, Christian Bible thumpers, who would get an amplification thing going and saying, "You better repent for your sins or you'll burn in hell forever." Like, you know, sit straight or you can get spanked or worse. And that was the motivation. Gee. For persons who are for persons in the mode of ignorance, that's how you control them. Threats, intimidation, bullying. So, but other people aren't going to be inspired by that at all. You know, it's not very attractive. Be better or else. Now, some people need that. And then helps them at least temporarily sit straight and repent for their sins and so forth. So I kind of like didn't like the idea of, I abhorred the idea of a vengeful, wrathful God. Ravindrasru Prabhu was narrating the story a couple of times, I've heard. He was speaking at the, there's a little a restaurant at in downtown Philadelphia, the South Street area where there's a few universities and stuff like that. And there's a little restaurant, and above that is a loft. So he was speaking at that place. And in the middle of the lecture, one man interrupted, young man, and said, "I don't believe in God." So Ravindra just stopped his talk and said, "Well, tell me, what is that God that you don't believe in?" And then the man started ranting about God, the vengeful, wrathful God. And Ravindra said, "Well, I don't believe in that God either. But here's the God that I believe in." And the man was like, "Wow." However, right here in this verse and purport is the angry God and the wrath of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. So that exists. Everything exists. I've been discussing this so many times with Prahlad Maharaj, where Lord Sringadeva was extremely angry. And then all this discussion by our acharyas about, wait a minute, what's anger doing in God? But everything that exists in its pure form in God. So the wrath or anger that we know, that we see people possess, or maybe even we possess to some degree, that's the modes of nature. And then there's another one that's without the modes of nature. And that's the one that the Supreme Personality of Godhead has. But his wrath wasn't just because he was insulted. His wrath is because of the disturbance of the entire Earth planet. Because of the greediness of his brother and the willingness of Hiranyaksha to serve that interest of his brother without any, without any care about the well-being of Earth and all the living entities existing on Earth and so forth. So when there's harm to others, this is a Vaishnava principle also. Someone may say something or do something, and we're told to tolerate. But if somebody says something, does something, to another Vaishnava, we don't just tolerate. We say something, do something. Let's say you offend a Vaishnava, you don't just tolerate. That's the instruction of Rupa Goswami, and it comes from the Personality of Godhead. Now, you don't have to be wrathful if somebody does something like that, but just tolerate. Now, here, we're hearing, he tolerated it for a purpose. Now, who can know the intentions of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, why he does what he does, what his contemplations are? But our acharyas have such intimacy in their relationship with the Lord, they can know. So he tolerated so that, for the benefit of the demigods, to let them know, as we're hearing in this purport, so that they can know the Supreme Personality of Godhead is always there ready to protect them. He could just have finished him, and of course that could be a message too. But the invincible Supreme Lord made this choice or preference to tolerate the insults and let the demigods know, I am here to protect you. Because they had come to him to seek his protection for the earth. Not exactly them, but their supervising or superintendence of the universe. And if a planet falls out of orbit, that's serious business. text 10. So here's Lord Varaha speaking chivalrous words. Indeed, we are creatures of the jungle, and we are searching after hunting dogs like you. One who is freed from the entanglement of death has no fear from the loose talk in which you are indulging, for you are bound up by the laws of death. Purport. Demons and atheistic persons can go on insulting the Supreme Personality of Godhead, but they forget that they are subjected to the laws of birth and death. They think that simply by decrying the existence of the Supreme Lord or defying his stringent laws of nature, one can be freed from the clutches of birth and death. In Bhagavad Gita, it is said that simply by understanding the transcendental nature of God, one can go back home, back to Godhead. But demons and atheistic persons do not try to understand the nature of the Supreme Lord, semicolon. Therefore, they remain in the entanglement of birth and death. Recently, I was listening to a morning walk conversation where one of the devotees was saying Prabhupada was speaking about the atheist saying God is dead. And one devotee said, there's this German philosopher named Friedrich Nietzsche, and Friedrich Nietzsche, during a certain period of time, was one of his themes was the statement God is dead. Then, like, you know, all kinds of writings about God is dead. And he said, recently I saw on a wall, God is dead, Nietzsche. Nietzsche is dead, God. That, you know, someone can declare whatever they want. The fact of the matter is, there is an authority above them that they are answerable to, whatever they may say. Like another example, a criminal may say, I don't care for the laws of the state. And they can say in prison, I don't care for the laws of the state. Recently, there was one man who long ago, committed a major theft, like a history-setting theft of some valuable jewels or something like that from some museum or something like that. And they didn't catch him. And so many years had passed, statute of limitation had passed, so he wrote a book about how he did it and published the book. And the police came, got him. Because as clever as he was, although the statute of limitation for his theft was over, there were other laws that he broke, tax evasion and other things, so put in jail. So as clever as a defier of the laws of man, similarly the laws of God, saying God is dead, so I don't have to pay attention to him. So that's what Lord Varaha is saying here. Loose talk of a foolish person, but you're in the jaws of death. Text 11. Certainly, we have stolen the charge of the inhabitants of Rasatala and have lost all shame. Although bitten by your powerful mace, I shall stay here in the water for some time because I have created enmity with a powerful enemy. I have no place to go. I now have no place to go. Short purport. The demon should have known that God cannot be driven out of any place, for he is all-pervading. Demons think of their possessions as their property, but actually everything belongs to the Supreme Personality of Godhead, who can take anything at any time he likes. So there was, this is responsive to some insulting words, or the specific insulting words that Hiranyaksha spoke. He spoke, you take the side of the demigods, but you remain invisible, meaning you're within everything. But you hide yourself because you're afraid of people like me. But now you've shown yourself, you're finished. I'm going to kill you. Thinking, you know, the invisibility of Lord Vishnu is out of fear. A mystic who has some fear. I'm afraid of the demons, so I hide myself. And the response is, yes, we're situated everywhere, including Rasatala. We, you know, the forms of the Lord. It's plural. And whatever exists, of course this is our topic from yesterday evening, whatever exists has a source. And that source is the Supreme Personality of Godhead, and therefore the source is the proprietor of everything. Although you're thinking, because he was insulting specifically that, you know, the earth planet, you're interfering with my business of taking gold from the earth, and now it's imbalanced and it fell out of orbit, and you're interfering. I wanted it to fall out of orbit, and you're interfering, so I'm, you know, you're dead. You take the sides of the demigods, but hide yourself, so you're dead, because the demigods are my enemies. So all these discussions of Bhagavad Gita, divine and demoniac natures, is being now exhibited very nicely by Hiranyaksha, as it is said in Bhagavad Gita, so he's exhibiting those symptoms. Friends and enemies is a big one. One more. This is the last little section of the Supreme Lord speaking. You are supposed to be the commander of many foot soldiers, and now you may take prompt steps to overthrow us. Give up all your foolish talk and wipe out the cares of your kith and kin by slaying us. One may be proud, yet he does not deserve a seat in an assembly if he fails to fulfill his promised word. Purport. A demon may be a great soldier and commander of a large number of infantry, but in the presence of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, he is powerless and is destined to die. The Lord therefore challenged the demon not to go away, but to fulfill his promise word to kill him. All of this, at least this particular manifestation of Hiranyaksha and Hiranyakashipu, it's nice to bear in mind their giant Vijay. And Jayan Vijay, aside from being cursed by the Kumaras, they're intimate associates of the Supreme Lord, and they know the Supreme Lord's mood, and part of his mood, or rasa, is chivalry. And who's going to be a contender for Lord Narayan in Vaikuntha, although he has this rasa within him of chivalry? So they prayed privately in their minds. Lord Narayan, we know that you like this chivalrous experience sometimes, but who is there that can be an a suitable combatant for you. So if you so desire, we can do that service. And to fulfill that prayer, this whole lila of the Kumaras coming to the gates of Vaikuntha, not being permitted by Giant Pichai, being cursed by the Kumaras, the whole thing. And then becoming Hiranyaksha and Hiranyakashipu, the first of the three births as demons. So while they're speaking harshly, it's an exchange that the personality of Godhead likes. No. He doesn't like, and he likes. Doesn't like, one way of looking at what Hiranyaksha and Hiranyakashipu are up to is they're against the demigods, and they're against the Supreme Lord because they're against the demigods. Something like Duryodhana, he's against the Pandavas, and therefore he's against Krishna. That's what Krishna said to Duryodhana. You say you love me, but there's no love because look at how you're behaving towards the Pandavas. You can't say you love me, but you despise the Pandavas. So they're taking the position of Hiranyaksha and Hiranyakashipu, wanting to assume the position of the demigods. There's this interesting hierarchy of regions described in the Bhagavatam, and the demigods are way up there. Excuse me, the demons are way up there in stages of elevation. Now, they're certainly the most degraded in terms of piety, but in terms of opulence and power, some demons have lots of opulence and lots of power. And to get that opulence and that power, lots of austerities. Because there's strength in austerities, but one who takes that strength and uses it for in opposition to the Supreme Lord, that's the demon, the asura, the sura and the asura, the atheist and the theist, the divine and the demoniac. So one way of looking at this exchange is, this is the Supreme Lord dealing with a demon. And another way is, he is enjoying his rasa of chivalry. So he's essentially saying, come on, let's do combat. Let's have at it. Keep your word, man. Let's go. And it's chivalry. Now, that another kind of chivalry is, say, insulting remarks, you're going to be, you know, powder really soon. You'll be food for the vultures and crows and, you know, those kind of insulting things. He's not saying those. Let's have at it. Bring it on. Let's go. Let's do battle. But in commentary of the Acharyas, they take these words, because this comes earlier in the same chapter 18, the insulting words are not appropriate for the Supreme Lord, so therefore an indirect meaning must be taken, and the indirect meaning, taking the Sanskrit terms, means glorification of the Supreme Lord. Our acharyas like doing that sometimes, in this chivalrous back and forth between someone opposing Krishna, or here someone opposing Lord Varaha, and the insulting words are actually glorifications. It's very common amongst our acharyas to do that. And it's according to Sanskrit rules, then it's appropriate. It's not, you know, cute, it's appropriate by Sanskrit rule. If some meaning is not appropriate, then you have to take a secondary meaning. Now, the intention of the speaker is insulting, but in addressing the Supreme Personality of God, it's appropriate that he's honored and all of that going on. So we're getting last, we're getting a look at the divine and demoniac nature. Certainly the divine is the personality of Godhead in full. The personality of Godhead is interested in giving protection to his devotees. He honors the brahmanas and protects the demigods, and you know, so it's because the brahmanas are to be honored, he honors, not just because, he actually has great affection for the brahmanas. He says it in a number of places in the Bhagavatam. It's not just to set an example, but the Supreme Lord has great affection for the brahmanas because of their regard for him. And then the demigods, they're controllers, but their controllers have someone who is the controller of the controllers, and if they're in difficulty, he gives his protection. And demigods, or Vaishnavas, devotees of the Lord, are those who turn to the Lord for protection. It's one of the six limbs of surrender, is Rakshikshateti Vishvaso, when sees the Supreme Lord as my protector. Even those that are giving protection to others see the Lord as their protector. A common thing, Prabhupada would say. So supposing a parent, some of your parents, would like to see the health of your children if they have some illness. And so you try to find a qualified physician or the best physician, you make all arrangements, but there's no guarantee that you get the best physician and illness is going to be cured, or your own. We're dependent on some higher authority. So as the demigods are seeking protection from the Lord and the demigods are challenging, so also parents, when dealing with the well-being of their family members, must seek the protection and shelter of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Not just karmically trying to do good things and make good arrangements and then everything's going to be nice. There's no guarantee. But if the Supreme Lord is there, then one turns to the Supreme Lord. It may not be how we would write the script, but how we should speak and do, etc. But his protection is there. That's the confidence of a Vaishnava, whatever their position is. Like the discussion last night about this emotion of feeling such and such feeling. You take that such and such feeling to the personality of Godhead. Because that's what devotees do. Not that we do nothing. Whenever we just go running every moment to the personality of Godhead, please take care of everything. We take responsible action. And when taking responsible action, we're fully dependent upon the personality of Godhead. That's the life of devotion. Mamanusmarayudhyacha. We engage in our prescribed duty. In Arjuna's case, it's yudhya, it's fighting. In our case, it's not fighting, it's something else. We engage in our prescribed duty and always think of Krishna. We're not independent. Material consciousness is thinking otherwise. Certainly, atheistic consciousness is explicitly, God is dead. You have to go to the trouble of saying God is dead. They're acknowledging him by making those declarations. Or there is no God. Show me God. Even the atheists know him. So there's the demigods or the Vaishnavas or those who are feeling themselves dependent upon the Supreme Lord, and those that are the opposite. And then there's the Supreme Lord. And how does the Supreme Lord reciprocate with this category and that category. And it's consistent. Not just, you know, only the demigods get the Lord's protection. Living entities who are turning their attention towards him receive the Lord's protection. It's just completely natural. Parents are interested in protecting their children. It's natural. Not just human species. Mothers and fathers are protective of their offspring, of any species. It's natural. And where does that come from? It comes from the Supreme. So those that are feeling themselves dependent upon the personality of Godhead, his protection is going to be there. And that's the trust, the faith, the confidence. And then life is lived accordingly. Not only when there's a difficulty, but in all circumstances. That's the message of the Bhagavatam. Oh, so we're hearing this kind of extreme situation. And the extreme situation has, as Prabhupada would say, in today's world, there's tiny Hiranyakashipus. No one powerful like him and Hiranyaksha. But, and they have their paraphernalia. He has his golden armor and this and that and the other thing. And the tiny Hiranyakashipus, they have this opulence, that opulence, and they like, you know, to show it off. That's like, you know, I'm opulent and I have power, so you better watch out. Come on in. The devotee may or may not have opulence, but the purpose of the opulence is not that. Bullying and intimidating and things like that. Life of devotion. Any discussion? Yeah.
Raj, that like basically all the acharyas glorify the Lord, and then sometimes we basically repeat the same glorification to please the Lord. It's one of the practice devotees do, like, you know, whatever the nice praising, or not praising, like, you know, like good, like Brahma was like praising the Lord, and like we take the Prahalad was glorifying the Lord. Those type of things we also glorify, and we see that like that's a good activity towards the Lord. Like something like this, like Hiranyaksha and Hiranyakashipu were blaspheming the Lord. So is there any negative impact reading this? Like, you know,
no. It's a pastime. And we just read, it's a pastime in which the Lord could have finished him immediately, but he wanted to demonstrate to the demigods, or we can say, demonstrate to us. He's always there. He's always ready to protect his devotees. So it gives us confidence. And it's, you know, if heard properly, it's glorification. The all-powerful. Have no fear. You're in his shelter. You're safe. So now when I'm safe, I can take care of my devotional service, my devotional activity, without worries. Because if one doesn't have that confidence, there are lots of things to be worried about. And not just terrorists. Lots of things to be worried about. Yeah.
In one of the purport, Prabhupada was talking about how devotees try to understand the transcendental nature of the Supreme Lord. Obviously, we hear from Bhagavad Gita also. So, how do we develop that understanding of the transcendental nature of the Lord?
How do we develop an understanding of the transcendental nature of the Lord? Well, start with hearing. And through hearing and chanting, the heart can become cleansed, and as the heart becomes cleansed, ignorance is removed and our real knowledge awakens, and then we can understand through the medium of service, not just, you know, the physical act of hearing, the mechanical act of hearing, but the devotional act of hearing so that I can become cleansed, and in that cleansed state I can then a little bit at least better understand. That's transcendence is revealed through sound.
Shelter,
okay.
So quite often, like, even if people don't intimidate me, but just their presence, having those opulence, it really intimidates.
Having that opulence is really what?
It intimidates me.
What does? People, when people are opulent and you're not? Is that what you're saying?
Yes, Maharaj, yes.
Materially opulent.
Some opulence.
Okay, some opulence. If others have some opulence which I don't have, I feel intimidated.
Yes.
So, what to do? That's the question.
Yes, Maharaj. Specifically in that situation.
Specifically?
In that situation.
In that situation.
In that moment.
In that moment. Well, we touched on this yesterday evening. And it was, you know, on what is suitable, according to suitability, we accept things. And the message was, last night, appropriate for your question, everyone is endowed with something. And, you know, it can be a different something, and it can be in different degrees. Somebody can dance. Somebody can sing. Somebody can do math. Somebody can run fast. Somebody can, you know, memorize things easily. Somebody, whatever. Everybody has something. And, you know, there's, in that different something, or combination, there's degrees. Like this question was there about golf. Remember that one? You were there? You weren't there. Oh. Some young person, I try to become good at golf, and I'm not getting much better. And then there's other people that don't try like I'm trying, and they're really good. You know, how do I process that? So, gifts are given, and what we should do is, in principle, two things. Whatever Krishna has given, be grateful and use that whatever Krishna has given in Krishna's service. And be happy that whatever I've been given, I'm grateful and I want to use it in Krishna's service. And somebody else has another gift, or somebody else has more of the same gift, whatever that is. That's, you know, it's the relationship with Krishna, it's not the comparing oneself to others. You start comparing yourself to others and feeling like you just described in other ones, where it's envy and, you know, fault finding. Well, they may have this gift, but they're lesser over there. You know, this comparing is from the material platform. It's not elevating. It's not productive. So, when that feeling in the moment, when that feeling arises, step back and you look to Krishna. Here's this feeling. let me think of the ways that I'm grateful to you. And so take that feeling and take it in another direction. Let me feel, let me experience my sense of gratitude towards you for what you have provided. And let me dedicate that which you have provided in service to you. Those two things, gratitude and using whatever Krishna has given. In any category, whether it's wealth or possessions or things that money can buy or ability or something. An expression that's used by our acharyas sometimes is, although I'm inadequate, let me glorify you. And then this phrase that a bird can only fly as high as his wings can carry him. So I don't know. I can only go this high, and I'll glorify according to my position. So do that. Take that emotion and go there. Gratitude and glorification according to my and making offerings. The antidote for darkness is light. You can try to wrestle with the emotion, or you can go to light, just, you know, directly. And then that emotion is far more manageable and even diminishes and even can disappear. Krishna's pleasure is everything. Whatever pleases Krishna, he can give me whatever he likes. Like, you know, Sudama. Nothing, everything. Whatever Krishna, Krishna's coming. And Krishna's pleasure is the life of a devotee. So go to the position of devotion. That's the light. Yes.
As you are describing, like this pastime has two ways. Krishna is one way; he's having that, experiencing the rasa chivalry, and another is
volume up because there's a fan right over here. Keep going, but just volume up.
Yeah. Another way is that he is dealing with the demons. So I was just thinking, like, you know, how. This the rasa that the Lord has the rasa with his devotees only when he in the intimate relationship is there, then that rasa will be there, and I'm not able to understand how that bhakti helps to, because trying to be developing that intimate relationship with Guru and Krishna, then how the bhakti is going to help.
How the bhakti is going to help what? Develop rasa?
Yeah, intimate relationship with.
Well, it starts with dasya. I'm the servant. I am the servant is nourished or awakened or the seed is fructified, sprouted by the chanting of the holy name. Krishna, please engage me in your service. For the internal potency, please. So, through that mood of service, the bhakti, the natural, the practical activity in that mood of service starts to awaken. And original consciousness begins to manifest the soul's original consciousness. And as that matures, it turns into rasa, unique to each soul. But we start with the mood of service, in contrast to the mood of, I'm meant to be the enjoyer of Krishna's the mood of service. That's bhakti. And as it matures, it becomes, it manifests various tastes of service in our relationship with Krishna. And augmenting and assisting others in their service to Krishna according to their mood of love for Krishna. So we have community or Vaishnava Sangha that's all towards the pleasure of Krishna.
Get a benefit of something for his family actually.
Yeah.
But finally he doesn't ask anything actually.
Yes.
So as a karma yogi actually he is having fearness sometime doing a devotion during his time. So how to handle that fearness?
How to handle fear specific to doing activities for Krishna. What kind of fear? Like Krishna may not give what I want, or what? That one, specifically? Well, here's how to handle it. Like a child towards their parent. When the parent is loving, then it's not only when the, using the example of Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur, sometimes a loving father will give some nice sweet milk. Sometimes the father will give bitter nimba juice. Sometimes the father will embrace his son. Sometimes the father will scold him. But the child is understanding the place that this is coming from is love. It's not when he gives nimba juice, it's not love. Or when he's scolding, it's not love. So, using that as an example, sometimes when we're doing activities with sacrificing the results under the Supreme, whatever is arranged for me in my life, that's good. The child is thinking. This Prithu Maharaj, nice example from the fourth canto Bhagavatam. When Lord Vishnu comes at this coronation ceremony, rather than asking for something, he says, just like an affectionate father knows what's best for his son, so if you want to give some benediction, it's whatever you want. That's, you know, it's smart, and it's right. So the fear is because the expectation has got to look like this. Or that. And if it's not this or that, then, you know, there might not be this or might not be that, then there's fear, anticipation of, I'm not going to get what I want. You know, again, a child comes wanting something that may not be wholesome, and they anticipate they may say no, so they're feeling fearful. And then when the no comes, my mother's and father's not loving because they said no. To understand these kinds of things as a parent is really easy to understand. So then you just, you know, take it up a couple of notches to the Supreme Lord in us. And he's loving. Aham Bija Pratapita, the seed-giving father of all living entities, were his sons. And we're doing things that are for him. What's the fear? His fear is I'm not going to get what I want. I have this business mentality, and he, you know, we don't have a contract, but in my mind there's a contract, and he's got to fulfill the contract. And he may not. Because it's the wrong position, it's the wrong relationship. The problem is over here, not over there. And the position of no fear is the position of service. My position, like Prahlad says to Lord Rishnigadev, between us there's only one thing. I'm the servant, you're the master, nothing else. So please don't ask me to take a benediction, because that's not a relationship. I'm the servant, you're the master. You can do with me whatever you like. I just want to stay in your service. This is Lord Chaitanya's teaching also. Then there's no fear. And the fear is due to our bhayam dutiyam abhinivesha taksyat, one of my favorite verses these days. 11th canto, chapter 2, you can look it up later. Text 37, I think it is. Bhayam, fear. Bhayam syat, fear arises when there's absorption in the duality. We're attached to seeing things separate and wanting to be enjoyer of that. Fear arises. The fear can be dispelled by don't see yourself as a separate enjoyer. If you're not a separate enjoyer, then what are you, or who am I? I'm Krishna's servant. And Krishna's kind. And whatever he gives is good for me. That's Prithu to Lord Vishnu. Whatever you want. Or Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, you can do with me what you like. You can embrace me. You can neglect me. You can trample me. You can do whatever you like. Because it's just one thing I request, your service. In any circumstance. Now, that's a high position. It's not, okay, got it. What's next? It takes some cultivation, because we're absorbed in the temporary and trying to be the enjoyers of it. That's why we're here. And if we didn't have that, we wouldn't be here. So we're absorbed. That's our conditioned nature. So therefore, fear, where the person's acknowledge that they have fear or not, deny it, there's fear. Because we don't know what's going to happen next. And it may not be what we want next. It's always going to be something we don't want. It's another place in the Bhagavatam says, Bhaktivinoda Thakur's analysis of avidya, or ignorance. Ignorance is fear. And fear arising from, I have an expectation, the expectations may not get met, so I have fear. I have attachment, therefore fear. Now demons boast, I have no fear. I'm going for it. Because I'm perfect, powerful, and happy, and you know the demoniac mentality. But it's a bluff. God is dead. It's a bluff. Nietzsche is dead. God. That's reality. The other's a bluff. So it's good to recognize that there's fear. And then how to deal with it, because that's your question. Something else?
Yeah. Prabhu, this goes, my question goes back to one of the earlier answers that you gave regarding gifts being is blessed with them. So I...
Gifts that what? God has given us?
Yeah.
Okay.
So, in other words, that is... maybe you can be taken as talent.
Challenge?
Talent.
Talent.
Talent. Okay, sure.
So sure. My question is, so what comes first? I mean, do you get talent depending on the kind of physical body you have, or the other way around? So any kind of, I mean, if someone is good at different things like sports or physical activity, likewise in spiritual matters, right? The talent of bhakti, if we can say that, is it also dependent on what kind of physical bodies that we have?
No.
Which one first?
No. Materially, yes. Spiritually, no.
The reason I ask that is, for example, if I just take the number of people who, for example, in my own family and extended family, if I just make an observation, how many people, by percentage, are actually really devout. So I'm thinking like, why is this running in families?
Well, that's another question, but scripture, particularly the Bhagavatam, gives many, many references to, for example, Gajendra, perfection in the body of an elephant, Ram and his associates, having nothing to do with even species, but to speak of, you know, genes, this family, that family.
But Krishna in Bhagavad Gita, I don't remember the exact verse, says, so for some, he'll send souls to those particular, to those particular families. Born in those particular families, I'm not sure.
Well, that has to do with piety. That's on the material side. So, if I've understood your remark or question, if someone is the unsuccessful yogi, as they don't complete the yoga process, they take birth again. And there's different options. They can take birth in the heavenly planets, enjoy for a long time, then come back. Or they can take birth in a, Prabhupada calls it aristocratic family or family of brahmanas. So persons that have wealth or persons that have brahminical presence in their life. And that's a benefit of, in this life, performing yoga but not completing it. But that's a spiritual asset that results in a favorable, not a guarantee, but a favorable circumstance for continuing in the next life. So some opportunity to engage in devotional service in the next life. Or engage in the connecting with the supreme process, the yoga process, in the next life. So, from spiritual well-being, material well-being follows. Like the shadow follows the object that casts a shadow. But so it's different, I'm just saying it again in a different way, but there's, for material talent, yes. But for spiritual well-being, no. Not, you know, analyzing the members of your clan and who is spiritually inclined and who isn't. It's the spiritual merit that has accrued that tells the spiritual inclination from one, you know, from one life to the next. I've seen it in one family, one child is spiritually inclined, another child is not. Same mother and father, same clan, same whatever dynasty, same, you know, group of relatives. So it's not just family membership, it's previous spiritual activity leading to a life of devotion, you know, greater devotion than another. Someone else? Yeah, way back there, Mahamantra.
Kumara, in this Hiranyaksha and Hiranyakashipu Leela, did these demons ever aware of their previous relationship?
Were the demons aware of their previous relationship? We have no indication.
So they're completely acting under...
It's the same question you're asking. There's no indication. It doesn't seem that they're just play acting. Okay, this is my script part, and I got to act like a demon. So I say these things and do those things, and there's no indication like that. They're in the consciousness of a demon. Good. Okay. Srila Prabhupada ki jai.
Yeah.